Also, BEST could not happen with a lot of sponsors. Up here is listed just a few of our sponsors. So recognize those individuals and those companies. On BEST Day, we'll be talking a lot more about them. There'll be representatives there. But let me tell you what, they make it happen. Money and otherwise, mentors, judging, you name it, they make it all happen. So if you would give them a round of applause. And if your company is not listed right now here, Robin will be happy to see you after this to sign you up. We also have another special guest, a BEST special guest, Ms. Rosemary Mendel. She's the new National Executive Director for BEST Robotics. So we've got the head cheese here. She is all the way from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Let's welcome Rosemary.
Thank you. It's just been so exciting to be here. It's my first time in Mobile. I arrived on Sunday, and it has been a whirlwind. For those of you who don't know, BEST Robotics has 45 hubs in 21 states, and we're serving about 25,000 to 30 students a year in the program. And our goal is to be in all 50 states. Maybe we can have a national championship in Hawaii some year. That would be fun, right? But I'm just thrilled to be here because it's been an opportunity for me to say thank you. Thank you to the sponsors, the volunteers. I want to say from BEST National, thank you to the educators who are willing to devote your time to this program. Thank you to the students who are courageous enough to take this on, because I tell you, I couldn't build a robot, so maybe some of you can give me some pointers. But what you represent, and no pun intended, is the best of our youth and our future workforce, our future STEM majors, and I just want to applaud you for being such outstanding young people. You serve as an example and role models to other students. So how about a hand for all of you? When I say whirlwind tour, Robin has really had me all over the place. I've met folks at Airbus, at Fargo, at Betzel Foundation, at the university, all these great mentors, sponsors, Yvonne. It is incredible to me, the core of volunteers and the core of support that we have. And if you can keep a secret, I'll tell you, I think we've got the best volunteers here in Mobile. All of you, teachers and students, the best of luck in the competition this year. And more than anything, I want to thank the Jubilee A-Team and Robin and Mark Fenton. You have showered me with Alabama hospitality, and I am grateful. Thank you.
Thank you, Rosemary. Led me into this. Without the following members, this wouldn't be happening either. Working tirelessly in the evenings after work in this beautiful humidity and heat and everything else that we do, building fields, getting everything ready, getting your kits together, wrapping PVC pipe, which I did last night, which was a lot of fun. Round things don't wrap really well, but that's a whole other story. So I'd like to introduce the hub director, and most of you know who she is, Ms. Robin Fenton. Robin, please stand up. We've been invading her home for months. She doesn't even have a house for the most part. There's somebody there all the time, boxes upon boxes and deliveries, so we definitely appreciate Robin and Mark our other half who has to endure all of us and all the meals that we eat. That's our only payment is food, which is fine by me, of course. So, last but not least, most definitely is the best 18 members. Please stand up. Off this coming Saturday, of course, you know, give them a handshake or a pat on the back, because like I said, they do a lot of work to make all this happen. Building two fields, we've done it now for a number of years. Building two fields is most other hubs don't have to do, but because of the number of schools and the time allotted that we have to have that. So that basically is double the fun. As last year, we're not going to get any prizes like we did last year, but still the social media aspect of death starts now. As you can see the hashtags up there, hashtag JubileeBest 2016 and hashtag BetTheFarm 2016. Let's start tweeting.
Would be interesting. There's a lot of robotics in the site there.
So there's four products that we make that are related to agriculture. Two of them are feed additives, and it's just like it sounds. It's products that you would add to a feed product. Methionine is the primary product, and that's mainly for poultry, although it can be used for fish and also for swine. Mepron is a product that we made from methionine and specific for ruminants, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. The other two products are fertilizers, and so Agrale is a potassium carbonate fertilizer that we make, and that's used throughout this region. And then the ammonium sulfate product, we call it blue sulfate, is either a liquid or dry product, and that's sold in the southeast. I'm not going to talk a whole lot more about the fertilizer products just because I want to make sure I don't go beyond my time slot here. So maybe to start off with is, what's the future of agriculture? So for our plant and for our business overall, we try to really pay attention to what we call megatrends, or where we see the world going and where we see the utilization of our product going. And if you look at that, some of the key things are is that over time we expect the population will continue to grow. Milestone we use is 2050. So we expect that population is going to continue to grow, and you're going to see a shift from people moving from farms to suburbs to cities, and so urbanization will continue. And what that means is that folks will be less able to produce their own food, so they're going to have to be able to go to the grocery store and buy food. Standard of living. So if we look overall, so the developing nations, there's a lot of people that are breaking out of poverty, and as that happens, they're more interested in eating, adding meat to their diet. And so that's one thing that drives the overall consumption of food, but also meat. And then lastly, from a technology point of view, we see per capita, you know, there's going to be more people, so there's less acres to produce the food that we need for the world. So based on that, we see overall the amount of acres that are available for food, or the acres to feed each person, is going to be less. And we may see farmers, or we will see farmers, that they're going to have to plant acres that they may have fallowed in the past, that they're going to plant them now. So because of that, they're going to have to add more water and use more water to plant those acres. So talking about amino acids and the correct combination of amino acids and amino feed, production of animals. So to talk about amino acids in general, or what are amino acids, that may be your first question. What's amino acid? Ooh, can't stand there. Okay, so amino acids are so like methionine is an amino acid. And if you look at this chain here, I tried to give you sort of a basic representation here, but like in your body, you've got proteins in your muscles, proteins in your organs, proteins in your skin, and those are assembled in a certain way. And so when it's kind of like going to a square dance, that everybody needs a partner. Well, when you're making a protein, if you have a yellow, green, red, and a blue, once you run out of one of those, then you can't use the rest. And this pile of blocks here, if you think of it this way, you can think of that pile of blocks like the hamburger that you just ate, or the corn that the chicken just ate. So once you run out of a particular one of these blocks, that you can't use anymore. So that idea is called first limiting. So once you run out of that, then you can't use the rest. So if you add a little bit more of the blue block, then you can use the rest of the blocks. I think we've all had that where we're making something out of blocks, so we run out of that one block, and then we can't finish the little car, the little building we're trying to make. Or at least anybody that has two 12-year-olds at home knows that. So this barrel, we call it the Leipzig barrel, so it represents growth for an animal. So if you think about feeding an animal, you're going to get where the water level is of growth, and then everything that's above that can't be utilized because, again, you ran out of that blue block. So if you can add a little bit more of methionine here, then you can get more utilization of that growth. And so per pound of food that animal may eat, you're going to get more growth. And then also, the other side is that you get less waste in the barnyard because they can actually utilize all those different pieces. So there's two ways to accomplish that. One is you just feed them a lot more, but if you notice, all the bars go up more. Or the other is you can add just methionine. And the question you might ask looking at this, you say, well, gosh, why can't they add more lysine, more valine, more threonine, more tryptophan? And at the end of the day, the sophisticated feeders, that's what they do, is they try to raise up all these. So there's very little waste, and there's very good growth out of the food that they provide.
Now you think, well, why does that really matter? Who cares about that? But if you have a couple chickens out in the yard, it doesn't seem like a big deal. But if you're feeding a couple billion chickens, a little bit more in the barnyard makes a big difference. And a little bit more corn makes a big difference. So, if you look at the benefit of methionine, it's really three key areas. So, again, improved growth. That's from a well-balanced diet. The second part is you optimize the feed production, and again, that's good for the farmer because they save money from having to feed the animals. And then the last is it's more environmentally friendly. Again, you can just get more, you get more growth on the animal and then less waste or barnyard. By the way, this is what the finding looks like once we get done building the molecule. So essential amino acids are indispensable for the growth of humans and animals. And so on this slide, I kind of segue a little bit to talking about human meat, but it means it's all the same story. We're talking about chickens, we're talking about pigs, we're talking about human meat. So if we look at our body, we're made up of 17% proteins. And so those proteins are made up of amino acids, and amino acids are essential for day-to-day life. So it helps with all of our key body functions, you know, repairing and building muscles, all of our tissues, keeping us hale and keeps us feeling well, helps digesting food, contracting muscles, all those key body functions. You need amino acids and need protein to make those things happen. So, and there's two groups of amino acids. Overall, there's 20 amino acids. There's 12 that are what they call non-essential. And so if you eat a burger, if you eat any particular ration, your body's pretty innovative that it can take what it gets and then convert it into what it needs. But there's a few things that it can't. And so the eight essential amino acids are those things that your body can't make. And so you need to actually consume those essential amino acids to stay healthy and strong. And if we're talking about animal production, if you're talking swine, poultry, or fish, they need to consume those to be able to use the rest of their ration. Because particularly for chickens, it's always binding deficient. For swine, it's lysine deficient, just as an FYI. So, the key thing, so if we think about animal protein in general, then amino acids are important for a day-to-day healthy diet. And healthy proteins are important for that. It's a key part of the human diet. And it's something that we see that the demand for protein is going to increase over time. So, the key things here are really quality and quantity. You go to the store, what do you expect? You expect that there's going to be chicken there, you expect that it's good, it's not going to make you sick, you expect that it's not going to be $19 a pound. And so, and if farmers are able to produce chicken at a good price, then we'll be able to have it and it'll be there at a good price. One other thing from an environmental point of view, so the premise of this is assuming that if you 1 pound, you know, so I showed where you can raise that stave by either feeding a lot more soybean meal or just adding a little bit of methionine. Well, 260 pounds of soybean meal is equivalent to 1 pound of methionine in a ration. So, and if you think of how you plant, what you apply a herbicide in the field, maybe you have to disc the field, plant the field, harvest the field, take the crop to the elevator, then you're going to take it to wherever they're going to process the soybean oil out of it. And you'll take that meal and take it to where they make the feed, and then that's going to go to where they feed the animal. A lot of diesel to make all that happen. So that 1 pound of methionine is equivalent to 10 pounds of diesel or fuel equivalents. In addition, all of that extra, you know, I showed you where you cut the barrel off and all above the water level, you can't use it anymore. What that means is that 1 pound of methionine means almost 8 pounds of nitrates that don't go into the environment, and almost 8 pounds of ammonia that doesn't go into the environment. So it's very good for the environment. And to give you kind of an idea, like a plant, like the size of our plant that we run in Theodore, will produce about 100,000 tons of methionine a year. You know, so just to give you an idea of what that 1 pound can do, and then take that times 100,000 tons. Alright, so meat prawn is a specially produced methionine product that's made specifically for ruminants, so specifically for cattle. And actually, it's for this type of cattle here. So these are the Holstein cows for folks that may not know cow. So the, you know, you think of a typical black and white cow, that's a Holstein cow. That's the one that we're targeting with our product. So these particular cows are high-yield cattle. And I mean, just to give you an idea, like this type of cow with a properly balanced diet will produce about 100 pounds of milk a day, or say roughly 10 to 11 gallons of milk a day from one cow. And the thiamine is the first limiting amino acid that you, for milk production. So if they run out of the thiamine, you'll end up with less gallons, and then also the amount of, well, my boy said they'll use the word goodies, but all of the protein and other stuff that's in milk that makes milk good, if you took a glass of milk and you evaporated all the water out, those, whatever you want to call them, goodies, there would be less of those if you didn't feed them the thiamine. So the reason why, I think it was an interesting thing for me. I've always heard that there's four stomachs, but there's actually a four stomach. So there's a stomach before the stomach. So this big thing here is like a big ferment. And a cow, they eat grass, and grass is cellulose, so it takes a lot of energy to break down that cellulose. So while they're chewing their cud and all that, you have all this bacteria that really likes methionine too. So if they eat just regular methionine, the rumen will, and the bacteria in the rumen will consume methionine, it'll never make it to the cow. So they never see the benefit. So you need something like this product. And what these are this is a match head here, to give you an idea. They're these little extrudates that are coated. And so they make it through that first stomach. Then when they get to the second stomach, that coating, it's like you take that slow-release excedrin, it'll break down and then release in the intestine where the cow can use it and the microbes don't get to it. So they get the benefit from it. It's really, there's a lot of science to it because you got to break down between here and here, but you can't make the whole journey, if you know what I mean. So you got to get it, kind of just right. It's no good to partner. So this is a picture of our plant. We built it last year. So this is a new addition to our complex. We started building it in 2014, brought it online in 2015. So this is something that we just added to our portfolio. Now to tell you a little bit about Avonic in general, I think this could be an interesting topic for you because, well, you can imagine with all this back here, there's a little bit of automation here. This is the methionine plant right here. The plant that's behind you is the Meepron plant, the one that you just saw. We're looking south in this picture. So the Avonic plant, there's 25 operating units, and for us to make methionine, we're three of those units, and then Meepron's the four. So our business is four of the 25 that are on site. Plant was built 40 years ago, and then, you know, it's grown along the way. The site, we have right about 850 employees, plus about another 300 contractors that are on site. And when we're doing improvements to the site, we may even have more contractors than that, but that's kind of a rough number of where we're at. This picture, sorry I had to blur out the screen, so there's a lot of technical stuff there, but this gives you an idea of like the control room for methionine. So there's two sides to it, there's two operators that are running the plant. And from this control room, so you see Jake, he's standing here, and this can be raised and lowered for ergonomics. And then Mike's over here running the other side of the plant. Everything that's in the plant, they can run from these computer screens here. All the valves, all the pumps, everything, they can start and stop it. They've got field operators that are doing things and confirming things in the field, but everything that you need to make run the plant, they can run these computer screens. So that's automation. That's what best, to the very best degree, you should imagine. Oh, and maybe the backup here a little bit. This is the methionine plant right here. And yes, we have our own little train. So that's what the methionine plant looks like. The plant sits here. This is range line, barge canal. So some green space around us. So we got about 1,800 acres, and then we've got about 400 of that developed. The site overall, so we support a lot of region. So our company, we have maybe 3 dozen plants in the region. And so we support human resources, procurement, engineering. We've got over 100 engineers on site, the chemical engineers, mechanical, electrical, civil engineers. They can do design and build, process technology, the whole thing. IT support, plus our assorted site functions and support. 45% of the folks are chemical operators, so folks who are actually going to be either running the plant or in the field making things happen. And one thing that may be interesting, certainly for all you folks that down the road a few years will be looking for things to do, is that we've got retirements that are sort of ongoing, and so that's one thing that really drives our hiring, is as people retire, they're looking for to replace those folks. So right now, average age on site is 47. So, thank you for your time and attention.
Thank you, Paul. I spent almost 18 years out in Ronick, and it's a massive place. It's constantly growing. They actually have several new plants that are, one that just went online not too long ago, and one that's coming online as well. So it's an exciting place to work. So this is what you're working towards, guys. Okay, for our next guest, Ms. Ellen Huckabee from the Alabama Cooperative Extension Service. Ellen. By the way, before I forget, you'll have your opportunity to ask questions, so make sure if you have a question, jot it down. Also, there will be a test. It'll be 25% of whether you win or never mind, just kidding. But, no, you write down some of your questions. We will have a giveaway for the first 24 that ask questions, so make sure you write them down and get ready for that at the end. So, Ms. Allen received her BS in Agronomy and Soils, that's a new one. In Plant Science and Education and Adult Education from Auburn University. She began her career with the Alabama Cooperative Extension Service in 2007 as the Outreach Coordinator for the Home Grounds, Gardens, and Home Pest Program Priority Team. In 2012, Ellen became the Regional Extension Agent for Home Horticulture in Southwest Alabama, where she conducted programs and workshops regarding best management practices for home gardens, landscapes, and sustainability for clients in Mobile, Clark, and Washington counties, and coordinated the Master Gardener class for Mobile County, which my wife, Susan, is a Master Gardener as well, so I know a little bit about that. Ellen is married to George Huckabee, also an Auburn College of Ag alumni, and lives in Fairhope with their son, Will, and bulldog, Bella. Let's welcome Ms. Ellen Huckabee.
Arm of Auburn University and Alabama A&M University. So we are bringing the research from those two land-grant universities to the public. We have an office in every county, and we are here to serve the public. So you are connected through the extension system to a statewide network of research-based information. But tonight I want to talk to you a little bit about precision agriculture. Auburn has been on the forefront of research in precision agriculture that will address some of those upcoming issues that Mr. Caldwell talked about. How are we going to produce more food on less land? How are we going to water those crops? And the answer to that is precision agriculture. Is anybody familiar with precision agriculture? Do you think you know what precision ag is? Well, very good, then you will be interested. Precision ag is more than just the adoption of technology on the farm. It's really a whole farm management system. with the goals of optimizing return on inputs or return on investments if you're a financial person, and also to preserve resources, to make better use of what we have so that we can continue to have it into the future. And it also does something that traditional farming systems couldn't do. It accounts for variability in the fields. In traditional farming systems, you're kind of using an average for your fertilizer recommendations and for how you're going to plant, how you're going to water. Well, Precision Ag allows you to take into account variability in the soil types and the topography of the land, and also in soil moisture, which can vary greatly within a field. There are many benefits to producers who adopt Precision Ag technologies, but what those benefits really boil down to are reduced pesticide and reduced nutrient inputs, and this affects your bottom line, so that can mean increased profits. And overall reduced input cost, of course, means that you have increased profitability. Another benefit is that farmers are able to make better and more timely information, or to receive better and more timely information for making crop management decisions. So with the use of these technologies, they're able to address problems before those problems cost them a lot of money. There are also benefits to consumers when farmers adopt Precision Ag technologies. The first benefit is a cleaner environment, because farmers are reducing their pest management inputs and their overall inputs. This results in a lower potential to pollute the environment or for a waste of those products. And this allows us to have the continued availability of that high quality, safe food at reasonable prices that Mr. Caldwell talked about. We expect to go into the grocery store, not only find chicken that doesn't cost $19 a pound, but we also want fresh fruits and vegetables that don't cost $19 a pound, and we want to wear clothes that don't cost $100 a shirt, unless you're paying for that label on it. And that's where these Precision Ag technologies will come into play and help us to produce more food on less land. Because as he showed in that graph, that is where agriculture is headed. There are three cornerstones of Precision Ag. The first, and probably the largest, is Global Positioning Systems, or GPS. So these are just like the GPS, the navigation systems in your vehicles, and now on everybody's phone. They come in the form of either navigation aids for the farmer to have on his equipment, or even auto guidance units where they will actually drive the tractor for you. We won't spend a lot of time talking about this because I think our next speaker is going to cover this in detail with some great examples. But we will mention that GPS is really where all of Precision Ag started. So the GPS technology is really the foundation for Precision Ag. The second cornerstone is global information systems, referred to in the industry as big data, when all lumped together. So you have these massive amounts of data, and you make it available to the farmers, to the public, and to people to use. So there are public GIS databases. These are things that anyone has access to. A very good example of a public GIS system is the NRCS Web Soil Survey that you can access on the USDA website. There are also private GIS databases that companies maintain with data from their clients. So they're taking their producers' yield numbers information about their fields, their fertilizer prescriptions, and they're keeping these in a database, not only to help that one client make a better choice, but to help all their clientele as a whole. And then the third cornerstone is variable rate technologies. So these include variable rate seeding, fertilization, and irrigation. And that's what we're going to talk mostly about moving forward. So if you consider, when you are making a farm management plan, the most important first step is to know what you're working with. What type of land are you working with? That's where soil sampling comes in. Traditional soil sampling was a great technology, but you consider the field as a whole, maybe up to 20 acres, and you took these random soil pores all around the field. You put all those pores in a bucket, you mixed it together, and you took 2 cups of that soil, sent it to the lab for analysis, and they give you a fertilizer and recommendation and a management recommendation for that land based on that average composite sample. So you are making all of your management decisions based on an average soil nutrient content. But precision ag technologies have allowed us to improve upon traditional soil sampling so that we can make even better decisions. In this example is referred to as grid sampling, and you can see why in the picture on the left. A field of up to 40 acres is divided into 16 quadrants. Within each of those 16 quadrants, they take 12 cores, soil cores, and mix those together, and that is one sample. So for 40 acres, you would have 16 different soil samples, and they are marked through GPS in the field, so you know which sample came from which quadrant, and your fertilizer prescriptions for each quadrant are customized based on the conditions in that quadrant. So this is a 15 times more intensive sampling system than traditional soil sampling. So we've already improved greatly on this. But the next step beyond that is referred to as zone sampling. So with zone sampling, instead of looking at every 40 acres and dividing it into equal quadrants, you actually use some of that other data, whether it's soil type, or yield data from a particular field, and you map out those zones within the field. You can do this, like I said, from yield data, and this is what most clients use in their field, is they look at a field, and they look at historic yield data, and they see where their most profitable areas were, and where their least profitable areas were, and they create a zone map based on that. You can also use the soil survey maps. You can use soil electroconductivity, which is a measure of the soil texture, or you can use aerial imagery. You can also use a combination of these methods, but as I said, the most common one is to use the yield map data. So when you create a zone map, the image on the left is what is created from the data. We'll use soil texture data, for example. So each area of that field is a different soil type. And this is a computer-generated image from satellite images. And this is what my husband does for a living, so I can talk a little bit about it, but he can do this from anywhere that he has an internet connection. So he has his clients' data wherever he is, as long as he can get on the internet, he can access this and create this fertility prescription that is computer-generated based on a formula from soil lab data. And y'all can spend the next several hours and days looking up that formula and how the soil lab does it, but we don't have time to get into it tonight. So then he takes that fertility prescription and sends it to the equipment operator in the field. And that equipment operator pulls up this prescription on the variable rate unit, and it creates this grid pattern for him. And this is what it looks like on the operator's control inside the tractor or inside the fertilizer spreader. The image on the right. Then the satellites locate the tractor in the field and read the prescription of that grid. And as the tractor drives across the field, it can either be automated by through the GPS system, or the operator drives through the field. It reads that prescription and applies the specific amount of fertilizer for the zone that it's in. So as you can see, the green areas get the lowest amount of fertilizer, and the red areas get the highest amount of fertilizer. Now, isn't this a lot better than taking the same rate of fertilizer and putting it on all that field, where the green areas would get too much and the red areas would get quite enough? Yes. Thank you. I'm glad you agree. Mr. Caldwell also mentioned that we're going to need about 110% more water to irrigate crops with in the future. Well, I've got some bad news for you. We are not getting any more water. The water that we have on earth is all we have. And there's just going to be more hands in the bucket. So we have to use that resource wisely. And Precision Ag addresses this problem that farmers face. So this variable rate technology can also be used to control irrigation systems. Has anyone ever driven past a field of cotton or soybeans and seen that tall sprinkler with the really long arm that moves in a circle around the field? Yes, okay, so we have seen that. That is called a center pivot irrigation unit. And these maps represent the path of the center pivot. On the left-hand map, you can see that this is a zone map created from soil moisture or soil texture data. And each wedge of this graph represents a sector as that pivot rotates around the field. And so with the sector-controlled variable rate irrigation, each sector gets a different amount of water based on the highest water need, or the reddest area. So blue is the lowest water need, red is the highest water requirement. So that's a great development and a great way to save some water, but when you look to the graph on the right, you see that it's further improved. So on the right is the zone control variable rate irrigation map, where the sectors are further divided into smaller zones. So along the length of the center pivot irrigation unit are different emitters, the water emitters that hang down. And with the zone control, you can make each emitter emit or apply a different amount of water in each zone. And so you can see that the whole sector that has some red in it, for instance over here on the far right, will not be getting that maximum amount of water across the whole unit. We'll only be getting the maximum amount in the red zone, not down in the green and yellow zones. Whereas if you were just using sector control, it would have all gotten the same amount of water. So this is a great way to conserve that natural resource, which converts to farmers for a savings in money. Another very neat thing that the variable rate irrigation allows you to do is to exclude areas from your field that do not need to be irrigated. So as you may have noticed driving around, you've seen those center pivot units, not every field is circular. So not every crop field fits into the exact radius of the center pivot unit. So in this map, the blue line represents the center pivot unit. The red line is the irrigation radius of the unit. Now, on the end of each center pivot unit, there is a sprinkler gun that irrigates another 150 feet beyond the edge of the center pivot unit. So that's why the radius, the irrigated radius is, circumference is greater than the length of the center pivot unit. So you can see here that with that zone variable rate control, you can exclude these forested areas that are not planted in crops. You can exclude roadways because roadways don't need extra irrigation, And those can also be sources of soil erosion that can contribute to pollution. And you can exclude these non-cropped areas or maybe areas that are not planted in the same crop as what you're irrigating, which equates again to even more water savings, reduced water use. And it also addresses the problem in the past where two irrigation units may overlap because you need to irrigate two fields, but this area here would have gotten too much water, which can be just as detrimental to a crop as getting not enough water. So with the variable rate technology, you can again have one of the units exclude this overlapped area there. Very cool. And again, these controls, these prescriptions can be written from anywhere with an internet connection. So we have been on vacation in Disney World. We have been in the Bahamas. And my husband just gets on his iPad, pulls it up, sends it to the operator in the field, and it's like he was sitting right there at his desk. So that is kind of where we currently are with precision agriculture. Those are some pretty well-developed technologies, but what is the future for precision ag? Anybody want to take a guess? Drones, unmanned aerial systems. So these are really the cutting edge and the future of precision ag. It's where we're headed. These allow rapid deployment of high-resolution sensors to detect geospatial variability. Basically, this means that a farmer can pretty much tell if there's a problem in his field in real time without having to walk over the field or without having to wait to the end of the season and collect that yield data. So the yield data and stuff that we talked about in the previous maps is great for future planning and for record keeping, but it doesn't really address real-time in-season problems. And that's where these unmanned aerial systems come in and allow us to do that. So the systems that look like this with the four wings, four propellers on top of the unit, are for smaller areas. So most of our fields in this area in Alabama can be flown with this type of unit. But for larger acreage, larger areas, maybe forested plots or large plots of land, these five-wing units are more efficient because they can go longer distance. And this is an example of the imagery that a drone would produce. So this field, this is obviously a center pivot here, irrigated field, but they flew this field and were able to tell where the fertilizer spreader skipped areas. Either it was broken or the operator didn't apply it correctly, but you can see these red areas here indicate that there's a problem with that crop that may need to be addressed. So the drones are equipped with cameras that detect red and infrared, green and blue colors. And this picture, this image on the left is the infrared image. This image is the green image. You combine them together and you get this prescription for the field, where again the blue areas are the very high performing areas of the field. The green areas are the average performing locations, and the red is the underperforming or the poorly performing portions of the field. And so at this point, you may think, well, just go dump some more fertilizer, or maybe you determined it was a disease that's causing that area to be red. Go put some fungicide, or maybe it's an insect. Go spray a pesticide on those areas. But at this point, the farmer has to make a decision based on money. So he's got to decide if putting more fertilizer on these areas is going to increase his yield enough that his profit will cover the cost of that fertilizer. So these are management tools, and he can base that on historical yields and what that soil is capable of producing in ideal conditions. So he can do all of this from his computer. And so we are very excited to see the things that you all come up with in this competition, because I, for one, really feel like that's going to bring some new technologies to agriculture, maybe give these folks some new ideas for what they should be looking to. So they're always looking for fresh minds and fresh ideas. And we have some great resources on the basics of precision agriculture on our website. ACES.edu, and you can search for Precision Ag from there if you're unable to read this website. The state specialist for Precision Ag is Dr. Brenda Ortiz, and she would be glad to answer any questions that you may have. You can reach her by email or phone. She is located in Auburn, but she covers the entire state. And then locally, we are also here as a resource for you. Any questions you have? I'm Ellen, and I have two of my other coworkers here with me this evening, James Miles, who is also an ag agent, and our county coordinator, Ms. Amelia Mitchell. So we thank y'all for having us.
Use GPS technology. I don't want to prepare somebody else's land, number one. I don't want to prepare land that I'm not going to use, number two. Because when I do that, I'll waste fuel and spend more money than I need to, right? Then this guy here, he's planting. And if you'll notice, there's no dirt there. He's planting in old crop. So that's no-till planting. And we'll get into that a little later about the GPS part of it. This guy here is spraying nutrients, insecticides, pesticides, and so forth, covering that graph she showed you a while ago. This is the payoff, harvesting. This may be a 8-row or a 12-row combine. And if you're sitting in the cab at the combine, it's hard to see way up there on that last row on either side. So GPS technology allows that combine to follow the rows exactly as planted. This technology helps the farmer control his cost of operation and field preparation. When we use GPS technology in planting and seeding to reduce cost and increase yield potential. Crop care, that's the sprayer you see there. We use GPS technology in that. And why? Because you don't want to spray somewhere that you don't need to spray, just like she showed you in the graph long ago. And with the control we have now over equipment, you can spray exactly where you need to spray and exactly what you need to spray on that crop to get the maximum productivity. GPS technology is also used through AutoTrac RowSense. Ellen mentioned that also, to control the combine in the picture I showed you to pick only those rows programmed to pick. So it's not going to be picking in a place where it's not supposed to be. In other words, you're not going to have a blank row out here on the side. It's going to pick every row, every ear of corn, every soybean, every grain of wheat. With so many advancements in technology, tractors can now drive, prep, plant, and harvest within 1-inch accuracy. That's pretty, when you consider a 16-row planter or an 8-row combine or a 120-foot boom sprayer, 1-inch accuracy is very, very precise. Field mapping. Ellen talked a lot about field mapping. The kind of field mapping I'm talking about is a little bit different, but not much. Field mapping has actually allowed farmers to increase acreage in a field. By taking advantage of all usable land, more crop, more yield, more money, more food for people and animals. The guy on the first slide with the two horses and the planter could plant enough food to feed his family, his animals, and sell enough crop to feed a few more people and a few more animals. Without the technology we have today, there would not be enough food to go around. And Paul indicated that, and so did Ellen. So what is the general theme running through these three presenters tonight? It's all about food, isn't it? The man with the horse-drawn two-row mechanical planter planted at about 2 miles per hour. Think about that, 2 miles per hour. That's a slow walking pace. Sometimes the planter would skip or plant two seeds instead of one at a time. The seed depth would vary and seed spacing would be off. In other words, instead of planting exactly the width he wanted to plant each seed, it would vary. On corn, you're probably going to plant somewhere between 4 and 5 inches apart, each seed. Well, if you plant 1 4 inches from the next one and the next one 6 inches, you see you've lost land, you've lost yield, you've lost a crop. So with technology, we can eliminate a lot of that. Today, with the technology available, planting has never been so easy. When you control seed population, seed spacing, singulation, downforce, and ride dynamic, all from the tractor seed, planting is easy. I'm going to call this row planter here, I'm going to call that my robot. It is hydraulic, it is pneumatic, it is electronic, and it is mechanical. Do any of you know what those terms mean? You're supposed to be robotic people. And this planter or robot right here, if you look right here, you're looking at a seed plate. That seed plate goes around here and picks up the seeds. They're held on this plate by air pressure or vacuum pressure. They go around and a vacuum is broken right about here and the seed falls into a seed tube. The seed tube allows the seed to go down into the ground and is also monitored. That seed is monitored from here all the way to the ground so that the farmer and the tractor can look at that monitor and see if a planter's plugged up, if it's out of seed, if it's not planting properly, if there's a setting off, if something's happening, he can correct it instantly before he gets into a situation that he doesn't like, and that would be a lot of land missed with exact seed spacing. By hydraulics from the tractor along with the mechanical setting on the planter, the single robot can plant more seed, a lot more seed, one row at a time than the mechanical two-row planter pulled by the horse. Using the technology we have, we can mount 8, 12, or 16 of these robots on a toolbar and plant at approximately, are you ready? 10 miles per hour. Now, when I started in the tractor business, before most of you were born, just about everybody in this room could either be one of my children or definitely one of my grandchildren. There's a few of you close to my age, but not many. We talked a little bit ago about 1-inch accuracy. We're talking about depth into the ground, how deep you're going to plant the seed. We're talking about from side to side, the row. Is it going to be within 1 inch of where I want it to be? And then seed spacing. I mentioned that a while ago. If I'm planting corn, I want it to be between 4 and 5 inches. And when I set my computer in the tractor to communicate with the planter of what I want to do there. Depth control is very important. You want the seed in the ground at the proper depth. And this is all done mechanically and hydraulically. Straight rows, very important. That's where GPS comes in. This technology allows farmers to feed the world. Without this technology, where would we be? Paul indicated where we might be. Ellen indicated where we might be. We would be starving to death. If we still had the two horses pulling the two-row planter, a lot of you in this room would not eat tonight. So I'm going to ask the question. How many of you like to eat?
I do.
To understand that agricultural technology is extremely important. We need you to take over. I can say that. I'm just about through. You're just getting started. You're going to have to eat. I have fed you for all these years. It's happening, you can take over if you need. Listen, your knowledge, talents, and skills are very much needed in the agricultural technology field. You are needed. How does it feel to be needed? You're supposed to be the smartest and the brightest available. We need you to feed the world. Now, there are opportunities available from the dealership level for Trey and I work to design, engineering, manufacturing, all of those. We have done a lot in ag technology since the Horsestrong plant, but there is a whole lot more to do, as indicated by Alan and Paul. Think about this technology. Think about the technology, all the technology that combine to bring your next steak, your next can of beans, and your next ear of corn to the table. It's all been talked about tonight. A lot of technology just to get a steak. And I would say that a lot of you people in this room believe that beans actually come in a can. They do not. You have to do all the stuff we've all talked about tonight in order to get those beans from the field to the can. So consider that. I want to thank you for inviting us. I want to thank you for your attention. And you're all always welcome at Sun South, where we strive to give the best service under the sun. Thank you.
Reduce the amount of farmland used to grow crops?
It pretty much already has, because we're making the farmland that we use more efficient. And as you see driving around Mobile and Baldwin counties, farmland is taken over daily by subdivisions. So we're still continuing to feed the world on less and less land. And that is going to be one of the main goals of Precision Ag.
Thank you.
Hey, my name is Paul. Factory. I know you talked about the environmental impacts of the products and how it lowers it inside of the different farms that there are. So in the factory specifically, what are those problems or any type of runoff or things like that that's coming from there?
Well, that's an excellent question. So this study that I referenced, that was a study that was done in Iceland, Germany, and it looked at, well, specifically the finding being used in feed. If we look overall at our whole complex, we really take a look at the carbon footprint from bringing the molecules into the site to having the finding leave the site. We're a zero waste site, you know, so we're not throwing anything in the dumpster. And there's, in terms of regulation, there's oversight on all the different aspects that we do, and we really strive to be a good environmental partner and also work with the community.
Thank you.
Thank you.
This is for all of you. I know last year safety was a big thing, but how are you encouraging safety? Because all the stuff you do doesn't seem like it's very dangerous.
So within the, like I mentioned, we have three plants that, well, there's four plants. One of them is brand new. So the other three that have been around for more than 40 years, those plants, we have some people that are familiar with OSHA have a recordable injury frequency rate or like a lost time accident rate. And for my plant, so a lost time accident, somebody would get hurt and they wouldn't be able to come back to work the next day for some reason. It's been 17 years since that's occurred in my plant. And for some of my sister plants that are on site, it's up to like 28 years. So it's something that every day we really strive to make sure that we make the safety of our plant better and better. And in three different aspects, through engineering controls, and also the behavior-based safety. So making sure that not only the folks know what to do and they have the right technologies to do that, but that when they go to do some activity that they think about it, and make sure that they do it in a way that makes sure that they're safe and all the people around them are safe, and we should ensure the safety of the community.
The question is about safety. In what respect? As far as equipment?
Just for people making the equipment that work
for you. Okay, the people that work for us, you know, we're a dealership of it. We sell, service, and repair equipment in our shop and on the farm. Our guys are required to follow many safety rules that are company rules. And they have equipment, the proper equipment, to go out into the field. So we use in our shop equipment that's labeled, and we follow OSHA regulations, and we also have a monthly safety video that everybody in our company has to watch and sign off.
I'm in culinary class at my school, and our culinary people was talking about basically the farm, jolly bacteria. Do y'all know any chance what the name of the bacteria is y'all use?
For bacteria on the farm that control pests?
Yes.
So one of the most common ones is the BT technology, which is the Bacillus thuringiensis bacteria that is a stomach poison specific to caterpillars. So it is in some genetically modified crops, corn mainly, and I believe there's a BT, is there BT soybeans? Yeah. Soybeans and corn. So this cuts down on the pest damage in those, and is also available as a product for homeowners to use, or over-the-counter products, so to speak, that you could use on your vegetables and It's very safe for beneficial insects, as well as for humans, mammals, fish, all those other, but unless you're caterpillar, it's not dangerous.
We're going to take, just real quick, we're going to only can take two more questions because this is a school night, of course. Those of you who are in line, don't worry, you're going to come up here and get one of your cups. But two more questions. So, gentlemen in the blue, go ahead.
The benefits of precision agriculture are great, and it is without a doubt saving resources and money for farmers. But how available is this technology, for example, to farmers who may be limited in funds?
Limited on funds. Well, you know, it's coming a long way and it's moving forward, and since it's trending towards the use of the precision ag equipment, it's only going to get more affordable. And for instance, what my husband does is he works for a company that already sells the farmers their fertilizer and other chemical needs. So this is just an add-on product. This GPS and this precision ag technology that they offer their clients is just kind of an add-on for being one of their customers. But the equipment in the field, I would say, and I'm going to let Mr. Charlie talk, that it is going to get more.
Farm equipment, because of technology, will become more affordable, but it's not because it's less expensive, it's because it's more productive. Also, financing for farm equipment is readily available. In our case, we're John Deere Financial, and they offer 0% interest on many pieces of equipment, which is a very good program for farmers. They also have parts buying plans where you can have a monthly payment on a credit card. So keep your credit good if you want to farm, because you will need equipment. Loads of equipment, unless you have a lot of money, you're going to have to finance.
All right, one more question, and the people that are in line, all of these guys will come and be able to talk to you individually, so don't just leave. If you want to ask them questions, they're going to come down here. Charlie and his crew are going to be outside by their tractor, so those of you who want to talk to them. And Paul and Alan will be down here on the floor, so feel free, after this last question, I have one more announcement, and then you can come down and talk to them individually. So, gentlemen in the red, last question.
Hi, my name is Tommy, and this question goes to me. The extension service mostly deals with data?
You said, does the extension service mostly deal with data? Actually, that is a very small portion of what the extension system does. So we, the professors and the PhDs at Auburn deal with all the data, and then they relay that information to us to pass on to consumers. So we mainly deal with education.
Okay, just one more round of applause to all three of our guests. One more quick announcement before I'll let these guys come in. You can talk to them all you like. Don't forget, this Saturday, 9:30, be there or be square. As the old adage goes, I know most of you don't even know what that means. But 10 o'clock opening for the kickoff. Be there, safe travels, be careful, and best rock on. So, two individuals down here, Paul and Alan, and Charlie and his tractor outside. Good evening, guys.
That's center.